I'd like to call a meeting to order of the Select Committee on Alcohol and Drug Abuse. We're going to have a special hearing on restructuring the delivery of behavioral health services in California and designing California's essential benefit. I want to thank you for attending today's hearing. I'm Assemblymember Jim Bell. I'm Chair of the Select Committee on Alcohol and Drug Abuse. And over the next few hours, we'll be joined by various members of the legislature as they complete their hearings that are now going on across the street. The purpose of today's hearing is the changing of the landscaping of our health delivery system in California has given California a wide latitude to redesign both the public and private treatment coverage for mental health and our substance abuse programs. As the federal government rolls out its health care reform and Governor Brown pushes for his realignment programs, California counties are shaping their benefit packages for eligible low-income uninsured individuals via their low-income health programs. The Assembly Select Committee on Alcohol and Drug Abuse is convening this hearing to gather information that will assist counties with their planning and help the state determine its basic coverage for mental health and substance abuse disorders, which will be offered under the state's health benefit exchange. We got to find the most effective way to deliver coverage to people who need treatment for mental health and substance abuse illnesses. Millions of Californians need but do not receive treatment for alcohol and drug abuse. I think it's critically important to make sure substance abuse treatment is not left out of the final benefit package. Now, today we have a panel of experts who will provide strategies and recommendations that can help California reach that goal. And in terms of our process today, we're going to allow the public to speak. We'd like you to fill out requests to speak cards, and we will call you and allow you to speak. It's a public hearing. If you wish to address the committee, please fill out these cards and give it to our staff members. And we'll have that afterwards. And our staff member of the committee, of course, is Sunshine Burley of my staff. Right now, I'd like to move on to our first panel. So I'd like to invite them to come forward, panel number one. And this panel we got some significant people here. This panel will review a new tool currently being utilized by several counties to identify the actuarial cost benefits of providing certain types of mental health and substance abuse services. This information to help counties shape their health care coverage initiatives, minimum benefit package under the 1115 Medi-Cal waiver. We have speakers as Dr. Sandra Naylor Goodwin of the California Institute for Mental Health, and Dale Jarvis is here with, he's a CPA with DJ Consulting. Santa Clara County Mental Health Director Nancy Pena is here, and Steve Kaplan, Director of our San Mateo County Department of Behavioral Health and Recovery Services. And we thank you all for being here today. And I think we'll start out, who do we have as the first? I think Dr. Naylor Goodwin is going to be the first presenter. And thank you for your good work in presenting this to the committee. I'll turn it over to Dr. Sandra Naylor Goodwin. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's a real honor to be here. We really appreciate the opportunity to share with you this work we've been doing, which I think is very exciting, helping California counties think about how to include mental health and substance use in their Medicaid expansion plans. So let me just start out, except I'm going nowhere.
There we go.
Ah. So, just briefly, let me tell you what we're going to be doing today, and then I'll introduce our presenters. What we hope to do is share with you this project we've been working on, which is to help counties, through using a modeling tool, look at what it would take for them to include a mental health and substance use benefit in their plans. Though that means that we look at the prevalence of the illnesses in the community, trying to figure out then what the actual unmet need is, how much of that unmet need is going to actually come to the county for services, what it will cost, what they're already spending, what additional federal dollars they're going to bring in, and what cost offsets there are by providing good services. So that's the general arc. We're going to spend a little time on the research that supports this work that we're doing, because I think the research is crucial. And I do want to point out that the research is real-world research, looking at actual services. It's not just theoretical. So let me introduce our speakers. You're going to hear after me. I'm just going to do some introductions and background, and then I'm going to turn it over to Dale Jarvis, who's our consultant, who's really done the yeoman's work here of putting this very significant modeling tool together. And then you'll hear from Steve Kaplan, who's the director of San Mateo County, and Dr. Nancy Pena, who's the director of Santa Clara County, because they're going to show you how it works in their practical world. So we're really talking about real services with real people. This is not a theory. So I'm going to run through the background material a little bit, some of the prevalence information. Dale Jarvis is going to talk about the prevalence and the cost of providing services for behavioral health. And then we're going to look at how you can use mental health and substance use services to actually bend the cost curve and begin to bring your costs down. And that will be through his tool, which really assesses the cost, the risk, and the benefit of providing these services. And then you'll hear from the two counties. So that's our plan, if that's all right with you.
That's wonderful.
Okay, so we'll start. I want to say that we started working on this this kind of task long before healthcare reform passed and before the waiver was real. We started on this because in 2006, we saw data and really looked at the fact that people who have serious mental illnesses die 25 years before the rest of us. So that was a real shock, and it was a shock to see that what they were dying from primarily was not anything related to their mental disorder. It was actually related to physical health concerns that were treatable and preventable, but these folks aren't getting treatment. So that was our first effort, is how do we get health care treatment to people with serious mental illnesses? And then, even more shocking, I think, is when data was looked at to see, well, so what happens about substance abuse? What if you combine substance use disorders with mental health? People lose another 5 years of life. So we're looking at lifespans of about 48 years of age. Now, for most of us in the U.S., our lifespan is somewhere around 70, 75 years. So that's a very significant and terrible difference. When we started looking at this and trying to figure out how to make it work, what we're talking about is what we're calling bidirectional integration. And I want to explain that briefly because that'll set the context for what you're going to hear. So when we look at people with mild or moderate mental health or substance use disorders, those people can get their services in a primary care setting. And there's certain kinds of services that are important to have there for those folks. So we're looking at integrating behavioral health services into a primary health care setting for that purpose. But then if you're looking at people with serious and severe issues, then that person needs to get their services in a specialty mental health or substance use setting, and then we need to bring primary care there so that those folks can get the kind of care that they need. This is a model we use, and I'm just going to run over this quickly because it helps to understand how we do this planning. This is what we affectionately call the four-quadrant model. And looking at this in the lower left corner, this population moves from low mental health and substance use complexity from that corner, and then as you go up this diagram, it becomes serious and severe mental health and substance use disorders. And then if you look across the horizontal plane, it goes from low physical health risk complexity to high, to serious physical risk. So if you look at the lower left corner, that is a population with low substance use and mental health complexity and low physical health complexity. Those people obviously should be seen by their primary health care physician and team. And we have listed here the kinds of services you'd expect to see in that setting you would need to have to serve those people appropriately. And then as you go up, we're looking at people with very serious mental health and substance use complexity, but low physical health. So those folks need to be seen in a specialty system, mental health, substance use, and then bringing physical health care to them. And then the other quadrants, it's the far right quadrants, the one that we don't want anyone to be in, and that's high mental health and high physical health problems. And that requires very strong partnership between behavioral health and primary care. So that's just to give you a context for what we're talking about as we're doing our planning. So just quickly, I'm going to share a little bit about the prevalence, and then you're going to hear more about this from Dale. This Faces of Medicaid 3 is a really important study because it really looked at the people with multiple chronic conditions, and these are the drivers of our Medi-Cal costs. So one of the important parts here is that 5% of the beneficiaries drive 50% of the cost. So clearly, we need to know who that 5% is. And
that's for all Medicaid, the entire universe of Medicaid.
That's correct.
5% of the beneficiaries use up 50% of the cost.
Yes, it's pretty overwhelming.
Okay.
And we got to this because in this study, they brought in pharmacy data and 5 years of utilization data so they could look at a bigger picture of who these folks are. And since these are all, the people in this 5% are people with multiple chronic conditions. Those are the folks that are in that 5%. And so it was important to look at what combination really drives the highest cost. And looking at these pairs, looking at the top five pairs of conditions, three of those top five include a psychiatric disorder. So psychiatric disorders are part of what is driving the costs in Medicaid. And you'll see in a little bit, Dale has a chart he'll show you so you can see what those disorders are. The other thing I think it's important to point out here is that of all the Medicaid individuals with disabilities, again, these are the folks in that 5%, 40% of them have a psychiatric illness. And then the last number that I have here, and I think this is important because the state just got a $1 million grant from CMS to develop to a planning grant to work on a program for people who are dual eligibles, have both Medicare and Medi-Cal. 52% of them have a psychiatric illness. So we've got to pay attention to this as we plan for this population. So quickly, I'm sure you know this, but I'm just going to review it very quickly about our new waiver, this bridge to healthcare reform, because that's what we're working on right now. California got approval for a 5-year waiver. Starts in November. Various implementations will take place over the demonstration period. When you look at the key programmatic elements, the parts that these counties are going to talk about that they're doing include expanding coverage to more uninsured adults. It includes supporting some uncompensated costs because they're going to be getting matched now for some people they're already treating. And it's certainly going to include improving care coordination for these vulnerable populations. The public hospital system is the only part of the four program elements of the waiver that we're not touching. And lastly, just to remind you, because we're going to be talking about these two programs exactly, the low-income health program has two components, the Medicaid coverage expansion and the health care coverage initiative. One thing that's different about these two is in the MCE, the Medicaid expansion, up to 133% of poverty, that requires a minimum mental health benefit. The health care coverage initiative, which is up to 200% of poverty, does not. Neither of these require a substance use benefit, although I will tell you, in looking at the plans submitted so far, 9 of the 27 that have submitted plans include a substance use benefit, which I think is remarkable.
Okay.
That's basically it. Just want to remind you that this expansion is going to be accomplished by using county funds to match to get this additional federal money. That county's got to figure out their risk, cost, and benefit ratio in order to do this. The research is really clear, and you're going to hear more about that, that if you provide adequate and appropriate Both are important. Mental health and substance use benefit, you're actually going to start pulling down the costs as well as improving outcomes. And the modeling tool that we're going to talk about looks specifically at those issues. And with that, I'm going to turn this over to Dale, who's going to talk about the instrument.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sandra. I appreciate being invited to chat with you this afternoon. To get an understanding of the importance of mental health and substance use disorder treatment, I think we need to start with the general overall healthcare system in this country. And these two graphs are, if you will, my favorite in terms of picturing what we've got going on. If you look at the left graph, it shows the preventable deaths per 100,000 people in this country comparing 19 countries. And this is deaths by conditions that can be treated, diabetes, epilepsy, stroke, et cetera. You think about what Sandra was talking about with the 25-year early death. And we, unfortunately, are number one, where we have 110 deaths per 100,000 folks due to preventable, not being treated properly or early enough for preventable conditions. And the other piece, so this is a real window into the quality of healthcare in this country, not for folks that have good healthcare and folks that have good insurance, but the average person, which includes 50 million people in this country that don't have insurance coverage or don't have access to good healthcare for other reasons. We also have the most expensive healthcare in the world. Everybody talks about that, but this graph lays it out quite clearly. We're 52% more expensive than the next most expensive country, Norway, and 88% more expensive than the third most expensive country, Canada. So this combination of high cost and quality problems as represented by preventable deaths is really the starting point for thinking about what's going on with our healthcare system, what does this have to do with mental health and substance use disorders. Now, I keep hearing more and more some of the leading folks in healthcare describing our healthcare system not as a healthcare system, but as a sick care system. Half of Americans in this country have one or more chronic health conditions. Over half of these folks receive their care from three or more docs. In total, treating these chronic health conditions takes up three quarters of what we spend in healthcare in this country. It's a huge amount of money, and this costs so much in large part due to the fact that money doesn't start flowing until after people become sick. If two doctors talk to each other about coordinating, or three of those three doctors talk to each other about coordinating a case, they don't get paid for talking to each other. So there's disincentives for coordinating care. There's a huge amount of waste in the system. It's estimated by most experts in the field that 30% of what we spend on healthcare is due to overuse, due to misuse, due to waste in the system. So it's not that we don't have enough money, it's that it's being spent in the wrong places. Now, I'm thinking about this two-part problem of cost and quality. And sometimes when I have a hard time sleeping at night, I go on the web and I look at up things that are relevant to my interest. And in this case, I pulled up the United Nations website for life expectancy of every country in the world. It's a nicely color-coded map. And I said, okay, so folks with serious mental illness die at age 53. What part of the world does that correspond to? It's sub-Saharan Africa. It's the orange countries there in the middle of Africa. And so if folks in this country had a serious mental illness, basically said, I'm mad as heck, I'm not going to take it anymore, I'm going to create my own country, that's what their life expectancy would be. It's really just such a slap in the face to look at it from that perspective. Now, when you think about the high prevalence that Sandra talked about of folks with mental health and substance use disorders and the high cost, and I'll have a couple slides that will say more about that, those graphs that we saw on the previous page, to a large degree, are affected by the folks with serious mental illness and substance use disorders that aren't getting treatment, that are ending up with high rates of health conditions and costing a ton of money to society because they're not getting the care they need when they need it. So this This affects all of us in our pocketbooks, not just folks in the public system. And if we start thinking about depression, it's one of the top 10 conditions driving medical costs in this country. It ranks 7th in a survey of employers. It's the greatest cause of productivity loss. It's an important factor in heart disease, along with high blood cholesterol and blood pressure. And people diagnosed with depression, as you see by the slide, have nearly twice the annual healthcare costs of those without depression. Now, what is the business community saying about this? There's a group called the National Business Group on Health. They represent over half of the Fortune 500, 64 of the Fortune 100. They provide coverage to over 60 million employees and their families. So they've been looking at this issue of mental health and substance use disorders. And this chart here is a really interesting window into what's going on from the business community perspective. And what this chart does is it takes healthcare costs that employers pay out of pocket, and it adds two very important additional bars, absenteeism and presenteeism, which is a term that's new to many folks, which is basically the quantification of lost of productivity problems. And what you'll see there is that the highest impact among the members of the National Business Group is depression, followed by anxiety, followed by back and neck pain that are very closely related to behavioral health disorders. The employer community that's looking at these data are basically saying, you know, Houston, we have a problem here with both the direct and the hidden costs of the mental health and substance use problems of our workforce in this country. Now, they're looking at that graph, and then they're looking at what they're spending. And on the average, in 2008, these employers were spending $8,400 a year per employee for the whole group, $5,300 in medical costs per covered employee, and $62 is behavioral health costs. Less than 1% is being spent on behavioral health disorders. And so you think, you just stop and you go, okay, so wait, what's wrong with this picture? The highest, the most expensive problems we have are behavioral health, and we're spending less than 1% of our premium dollars on these services. And there's a whole complex set of reasons why this is going on. But the CEOs of these Fortune 500 companies are basically saying, this is clearly a system that's broken in terms of the funding and financing of behavioral health services in this country. Now let's shift gears and talk about the public sector. Sandra was talking about the pairs of diagnoses. And if we look at the top five diagnoses among the Medicaid population, psychiatric cardiovascular, psychiatric central nervous system, psychiatric pulmonary, three of the top five have a psychiatric illness. In Washington State, they ran the numbers. And they said, they called this population the 550. 5% of the Medicaid enrollees use up 50% of the resources. And if you're trying to address healthcare costs in not only the general population, but the Medicaid population, if you ignore the behavioral health disorders or you don't adequately fund and treat them, you're not going to address the problems. If you talk to any primary care doc in this country and you say, okay, you have here's a patient, depression, diabetes. Do you really think you can help that patient manage their diabetes if you ignore their depression or don't adequately treat it? It's very clear to the healthcare community that this is a problem that's not helping any of us get to the other side of the quality and cost problems. This was a study done for California Medi-Cal population where we see.
Who are these studies done for?
So this particular, the previous study was done, it was commissioned by, I believe it was either the Kaiser Foundation or the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation.
Okay.
And this was done by the folks at University of California in San Diego.
Okay.
And this study looked at all the Medicaid claims in the whole country.
Wow.
This next study focused in on California. It was commissioned by the state looking at the Medi-Cal the folks that were in Medi-Cal fee-for-service, and they did an interesting thing. They said, let's take everybody that's in Medi-Cal fee-for-service. We need to better manage this population. We need to bring them into an organized system of care. And so they looked at the cost. They said, okay, we're spending $3,900 a year on the average for these Medi-Cal enrollees. And then they said, now let's take a slice of those folks, the folks with a serious mental illness, which represents 11% of the population. It costs us $14,000 a year, 3.7 times more for their total health care expenditures. And so people are looking at 3.7 times more. Well, what's this being spent on? And so if you look at the list, the first thing you see is these folks have roughly three times higher rates of diabetes, heart disease, arthritis, major health conditions. And what we're spending the money on is not mental health and drug and alcohol services. It's acute inpatient visits. It's emergency room visits. It's primary care and specialty visits. So what we're seeing is huge amounts of health care that's going towards these folks. And what we're finding is because what's happening is they're getting treated too far downstream. They're not getting the kind of prevention, early intervention, care management that can help them better manage both their behavioral health conditions and their physical health conditions. And not only is it leading to higher, earlier death rates, but it's costing the taxpayer a huge amount of money along the way. And this is like the poster child for having not a true healthcare system in this state, in this country, but actually a sick care system.
So you're saying that the fee-for-service Medi-Cal cost for the state of California, there's $6.2 billion. And of that, $2.4 billion is spent on Medi-Cal seriously mentally ill.
Yes, that's
patients.
Correct. That's correct. And it's mostly...
39% of the total.
Yes. Yes, this is a huge, huge... If you're going to look at addressing that 550 problem, what's happening right now is we're not adequately tackling what is it that these folks have going on in their lives. How do we best manage the care so that we can bring these costs down?
Their conditions like diabetes and so forth looks like generally about three times the average of the total population.
Yes, that's correct. That's correct. That's correct.
So they have more, I would say, serious health problems in general, but probably uncontrolled health problems. Would you use that as a way of describing it?
Yes, that's right.
Just not cared in a coordinated fashion?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
That's right. In a few slides, I'll talk more about that. But that's, you've already found, come to the punchline, which is that the care is not coordinated. It's not adequate. People are not getting their needs met when these problems are presenting themselves.
Okay.
This next slide talks about the most expenses of the most expensive. That last slide talked about the $14,000 average. The folks at highest risk, there's 9,500 Californians with a serious mental illness that cost the state $50,000 a person per year. And so as you go up, as you sort of stratify this further, you start seeing that we're really talking about very, very high cost folks not getting the right kind of care that they need at the right time. And what's fascinating about this is these data have been around for decades, but no one has bothered to slice the pie by saying, okay, how much does it cost everybody? Now let's look at the folks with serious mental illness, let's look at the folks with serious substance use disorders and see how they compare. I think that there's a huge amount of stigma and a huge amount of blind spots that have gone into simply not looking at the data that's already there. It's only been in the last couple of years that this stuff has started to fall out onto the table as folks are realizing that we have a serious problem that's not been adequately described, adequately analyzed.
Are other states ahead of California in analyzing these comorbidity issues such as you're displaying here?
Well, what's happening is that there's There's a very similar kind of awareness that's taking place. I would say that Washington State is the state that's furthest along. They've been doing this for about 10 years now, and I actually have a very interesting slide. California is not on the trailing edge, but they're not on the leading edge of this data. But it's very quickly becoming very prominent among systems throughout the state as to we can't fix the healthcare problem in California without addressing mental health and substance use disorders. Okay. I want to talk, okay, so that's the bad news. Let's talk about the good news. How to go about bending the cost curve.
Yeah, we like good news in Sacramento. They don't get very much of it.
Yes, that's right. That's right. So I really like Deep Throat's line, follow the money, in Bob Woodward's account of Watergate. And I think about what's going on in the healthcare system in this country and in California is we have an upside-down triangle where we're spending a very, very large amount of money on all things inpatient and institutional care because we're underfunding primary care, prevention, and behavioral health. And what we need to do is flip the triangle. We need to spend more on prevention, primary care, mental health and substance use disorder assessment and treatment must become the standard of care in order to decrease demand in the specialty and acute care systems. Now, the 1115 waiver, this is what it's about. It's about creating system of care in the state to actually help flip the triangle. And the 1115 waiver made some baby steps towards including a mental health benefit but left out the substance abuse benefit from the waiver. So if you want to think about I would suggest the triangle is teetering between whether it's going to flip or not before 2014. And what's happened is because the waiver says mental health and substance use benefits can be optionally added by the counties, the ball right now is in the county's court to do that work to flip it. So that's what we're going to spend most of the rest of our time talking about. Okay. Last year, we put together a paper for CIMH called The Business Case for Bidirectional Integrated Care. What we did was we pulled together all the research around the country about how to go about doing this. If you ever have insomnia, go to the last five pages of this report because there's five pages of very small type references of all the studies that say if you want, and here's the research that's been coming out fast and furious about how to fix this problem.
And that business case actually is in those handouts. So yeah. You have that in case you do have insomnia.
Yes.
One of the largest actuarial firms in the country, Milliman, completed an analysis where what they stumbled across was folks with chronic medical conditions and co-occurring depression or anxiety, guess what, cost us $505 per member per month more than folks without comorbid depression. Comorbid anxiety cost $650 more per month per person. And they ran the numbers. If you had a 10% reduction in excess healthcare costs by providing better care, you could save $5.4 million for every group of 100,000 insured members, and quantified this as a $300 billion per year problem in the U.S. So what they're basically saying is if you just did a little bit better addressing integrating care for these folks, you could save a ton of money.
The Milliman study is from where?
That's a national study looking at employer. This is at employer data as opposed to public sector Medi-Cal data.
So the private insured?
Yes, private insured population.
The private insured population.
So we're talking about every Californian is affected by whether they have private sector coverage, whether they pay for it out of their own pocket, their employer, whether they're in the Medi-Cal system, whether they have state-funded coverage, whether they're uninsured, these costs are affecting every nook and cranny of the healthcare system in this state.
It's kind of interesting because in the 4 years I've introduced the mental health parity bill this data from Milliman never was revealed in any of the studies that we received from them.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's very interesting, and I wonder why the University of California hasn't put that in their report.
Good question.
For five years.
Yes, that's right.
It's right there. I mean, they have a study. It's $505 per member per month. That's a lot of money.
That's right. Now, going up to our neighbor, Washington State, the fellow that used to run the drug and alcohol system up there, his name is Ken Stark. He has a saying that for every foot of research that he brought to the Washington State legislature, he would get an inch of additional funding.
Okay, are those in million-dollar checks or $10 million checks?
So this represents his inch of funding. He convinced the legislature to increase the funding for drug and alcohol treatment in the state. This is a very important study. This study has caught the attention of everybody in the country. Over 4 years, Washington spent $52 million more money. It's the far right-hand column. With one purpose in mind, to get more folks in the Medicaid system into drug and alcohol treatment. And what they found, they just finished the research study last October, they found that they saved $107 million. It's the second from the right-hand column. The $51 million brought a return on investment over 4 years of $2.07, $107 million. So they saved the state just under $56 million. And if you had a little calculator and you add that up year one, year two, year three, year four, by year four, they saved in the Medicaid disabled, the Medicaid skilled nursing home, medical costs, skilled nursing home costs, and this program called General Assistance to the Unemployable, they saved $58 million on a $16 million investment. So the savings kept growing year by year. And it became very clear that what we're talking about is a little bit of money actually is going a long ways. It's not just these arcane research studies that say, well, maybe it'll work, maybe it'll make a difference. This is a printout from a couple of the pages of the business case. And if you were to read through the study, I'm not going to go through the details here. Study after study is showing not only are the costs higher, but if you provide treatment, you actually save money. If you provide mental health and substance use disorder treatment, you can save money. Kaiser, Northern California, had a groundbreaking study. Connie Wisner, who's the head of research there, I was on a panel with her last year where she just presented, they were just finishing up their study. If you are a person with a drug and alcohol disorder and you have a family, your family's health care costs are higher than a family where one of the adults doesn't have a drug and alcohol problem. And if you treat the person with a drug and alcohol problem, the family's health care costs come back down to average. So this is wow. Not just it's the healthcare costs of the individual and the family members that are being impacted by these disorders and by lack of treatment of these disorders. And it is reversible if you provide treatment. So what Kaiser and their Medi-Cal population, they don't have responsibility for the mental health and drug and alcohol benefit, and they're providing those services because she was saying that when Parity Bill came out and employers started coming to Kaiser saying, should we drop our drug and alcohol and mental health coverage? Kaiser in Northern California said, you better not, because if you do, we'll have to raise your premiums. Because it costs less if we provide the treatment than if we don't provide the treatment.
If you had a group of people that were high propensity for substance abuse disorders, and you drop the coverage for substance abuse disorder,
yes,
would that over time severely increase the premium cost?
Yes. Yes.
So the Screen Actors Guilds are going to be in big trouble then.
Yes, exactly.
Because they dropped their coverage.
When I read that, I said, they haven't been reading the research. That's right. That's absolutely right.
And 100,000 people that won't have coverage now.
Yes. The other problem that there's another Washington State study that came out that said there's a very, very important problem number two if you do something like the Screen Actors Guild, which is if somebody has a drug and alcohol problem that isn't treated and it's a serious problem, they're on their way towards a health disability. And once that person becomes physically disabled because of their drug and alcohol problem has trashed their body to the point where they can no longer work, they basically become a ward to the state, a very, very expensive ward to the state. And in the Washington study that the fellow who wrote it started working on quantifying how much money you could save the state in total if you're able to either delay or prevent disability due to good drug and alcohol treatment. This is a very important piece of the puzzle.
Okay.
A few more slides, and then we'll move on to what's happening specifically in the counties. The Federal Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration has a mantra, a new mantra: prevention works, treatment is effective, people recover. And what we're really talking about is as you know, my little picture shows, we really are reconnecting the head with the body in order to provide much more holistic care, in order to save money and improve the quality of care. So this brings us into what we've been doing with the counties. I've been working on this project with where I've built this computer model for the California Institute of Mental Health, trained about 3 dozen counties on how to use it. And there's a couple of slides that was part of the training. What is a modeling tool? Dale's been hired by CIMH to build a computer model the counties can use to analyze the financial impact of moving into the coverage initiative expansion. It will help you understand how much it might cost to expand coverage before 2014 and how much additional federal Medicaid funds can be pulled down. Question, what's the point? To try and help your county answer the question, if we do this in our county, will we be better off or worse off financially? So they've been pulling numbers together, doing the financial analysis of how the coverage expansion will affect them. And what we're trying to accomplish is 6 questions. How many people do I want to test bringing into the coverage initiative? How many people will receive mental health and alcohol and drug services? What do I anticipate spending per person per year? How much will the total spending be? How much will be available from the feds to help offset this? And am I going to lose money or make money? So this is a really very robust little tool that allows folks to answer the question, how much money can I save by providing mental health and drug and alcohol versus not? And how much federal money can I bring in as part of this 1115 waiver? So some early results are in. This is from San Mateo. And will I mess things up if I walk up to the screen in terms of the microphone? Or I can talk.
Grab that mic there.
Pardon me?
Just grab that mic.
Great.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah. It's okay. So.
Yeah, stand on that side.
So what we did was we analyzed all the services that were provided in the San Mateo system for Medi-Cal folks and uninsured folks. And we looked at those folks from the perspective of how many chronic health conditions do they have, and whether they have a mental health and drug and alcohol or drug and alcohol disorder, and whether that mental health and drug and alcohol disorder was treated. And I'm not going to go into the painful detail, but what I want to point out is if you have no chronic health conditions, your health care costs look like the Jen Associates study, about $2,000 to $3,000 per year.
Those are actual San Mateo County numbers.
Yes.
Okay, these, that's actual.
This is, so this is.
Numbers 2 years ago, this looks like.
That's right. That's right.
July 2008 to June 2009.
That's correct.
Okay.
And what we found is that people with mental health, I'm sorry, with multiple chronic health conditions cost more. The more that you had, the more conditions you had, the greater your total health care costs were. And if you had a mental health disorder, your costs were higher than if you didn't, in every category. What we were doing was, we were saying, well, you know, it's fine for the Gen Associates to do it for California. It's fine for Rick Cronick in San Diego to do it for everybody in the U.S., but we really need to know what's happening in specific counties. We're working on the Santa Clara data now. We finished the San Mateo data. And the short version of this is that we found that if you do have a chronic health condition, it would make sense your health care costs are a lot more. And if you have a mental health disorder, layered onto that, your costs are even greater. And if that mental health, and if the mental health and behavioral health or drug and alcohol condition isn't treated, your costs are even greater. So that this is the same slide that shows the folks who are uninsured. And without going into painful detail, I want to point out that what we found overall was that if you look at the lower bottom hand corner of the slide where it says $384 right above the date, -$384.
Right.
And then the next slide, -$1,400. What we found is in a preliminary analysis is that if you treat the behavioral health condition, your health care costs are lower, which parallels the national studies that is in the business case paper.
Now, when you say San Mateo County patients, you're talking Medi-Cal healthy families or?
Yes.
They're public assisted.
Now, and this is all adults. So this is 18 plus, 18 plus, Medi-Cal over 18, uninsured in the their first coverage initiative over 18.
So these are people that would go into the coverage initiative.
Yes.
Partly, these are people in our first coverage initiative.
Okay, got
as
it.
Well as those that will be with the additional eligibility.
Okay.
And so I know that there are a lot of numbers on this, but the main story to tell is what we found is that folks who got treated for their mental health and drug and alcohol disorder in San Mateo during this year in this population had lower health care costs than those that had a mental health disorder or drug and alcohol disorder and didn't get treated. So what we're finding is that the studies keep reinforcing each other that the costs are higher if you have a mental health or drug and alcohol problem. You can bring them down if you provide treatment. So we built a model that shows that there, you know, that we summarize there's a trend. What we also found was that in the Medi-Cal population, if people got sick enough to the point where they had three or more chronic health conditions, their costs weren't necessarily lower by just providing mental health and substance use disorders, because this population is much more complicated. And I think we have not yet funded or set up enough care systems in California to treat the sickest of the sick. And until we actually need to develop more robust treatment systems to actually start bringing the cost down for the folks that really have fallen off the cliff.
That looks like the costs are almost the same for really severe. Am I missing something there?
Yes. And
so
that's
if you wait too long, it's just too late to really. In terms of saving money, if you look at it financially.
Yes, exactly.
But if you go early and take care of it, you have your biggest dividends.
Yes.
You want to say it that way, or the earlier treatment?
That's right. So again, that's a very astute synthesis on the spur of the moment of those four rows. And that's absolutely correct. And so what happens is when you get to three.
Well, plus, I talk county stuff. I'm a county supervisor for 12 years.
Okay.
I look at this stuff.
So when you get up.
I wish I'd look at it up here. I never see this kind of stuff up here in Sacramento. I used to see it all the time at the county.
That's right. So we've been working on the modeling for San Mateo. And again, we're going to be doing this with Santa Clara after we finish the data analysis. And what we're projecting is that by providing mental health and drug and alcohol treatment in their low-income health program over 3 years, they'll save, where the arrows are, $1.6 million in year one, $1.9 million in year two, $2.3 million of health care costs. And this is relatively conservative. By having a mental health and drug and alcohol benefit for the folks that are coming into the low-income health program. And so this is, so what we're basically doing is we're saying the strategy in San Mateo, and again, Steve will talk about this, is provide a benefit, save money on the healthcare side, and also be able to bring down a substantial, you know, 50 cents on the dollar of federal money to help cover the costs of the mental health, drug and alcohol, and healthcare costs.
Where does that federal money come from? Is that the waiver?
Yes, that's through the waiver.
Okay.
The federal matching dollars.
Oh, that's a matching. Okay, got it.
I'm not going to dwell on the last three slides. I just put them in for folks to be able to review at some of the wiring behind this summary page. But I do want to end on, we've added a fourth bullet to which we think ought to become California's bridge to reform mantra, which is integrated mental health substance use and primary care services can save money and lives. And on that note, I'll turn it over to, I believe, Steve.
Okay,
this
thank
is
you.
The magic button.
That's
yep.
it.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, well, good afternoon. So we'll take this down to the operational level a bit. We're true believers in Dale's
and
data.
I was sharing this data with one of your former county supervisors before the meeting.
Good.
Mr. Gordon.
Good. Well, he's been very interested. Yeah, he's been a great supporter of what we've been doing over the last several years. So for a while, and the MHSA certainly was an impetus, that we've really shifted our focus in the county to a total wellness perspective, which is really, I think, describing what Dale was saying in numbers, that we believe that ultimately we have to treat and approach the total well-being of a person, not just their psychiatric or substance use disorder, but we have to look at their health conditions, these comorbid health conditions, be involved in preventative strategies to reduce the likelihood of those occurring. And we do that both at the front end with people coming into our primary care all the way through specialty services. But that's our general orientation to approaching what we do. We have strong partnerships in the county. We have the luxury, if you will, of a single county-organized health system with the Health Plan of San Mateo, and that provides great advantage to San Mateo County. They're a key partner and a willing partner who sits at the table with us to look at all this information. The partnership has, in our orientation towards this total wellness, has created some restructuring in the county in order to try to break down some of the barriers of the silos into more integrated care. So a number of things that occurred about 3 or 4 years ago, we integrated our mental health and substance use prevention and treatment into a single behavioral health and recovery services organization in the health system. We changed our health department to a health system, including our San Mateo County Medical Center and clinics. So we have leadership that's looking at all facets of our entire health system together and planning things like the implementation of the waiver, and I think it served us really well. We've focused, and this slide doesn't do it great service because I did this, but the middle where it's shared clients is really the group of individuals that we spend a lot of time really focusing on. And Dale's data really helps us get to a level of specificity where we can really start breaking down what's happening to very discrete groups of people that we share responsibility for. We did a point-in-time study a little while ago to get a sense of the insurance status of people that were currently in our mental health and substance use treatment programs, just to get an idea of, as we approach the waiver, how many people we think might be eligible for the waiver, whether or not we had opportunities with our private insurers in the county to try to improve access to care, et cetera. So a couple things that stand out in this study, and this is an aggregate of all mental health and substance use clients. We've disaggregated mental health from substance use to see what the differences were in those populations. But we have a fairly sizable number of people that have private insurance coverage that we don't believe really is a willing or active partner in addressing their health care or their substance use and mental health treatment needs. And I think some of what Dale says is kind of reinforced by what we found with that particular piece of data. The other is that when we disaggregated this, over 60% of the substance use treatment clients do not currently have any insurance. So they fall in our uninsured pool. But we do believe that up to 50% may qualify for the waiver, which will now provide them with health insurance and
for the exchange program.
For the
exchange.
Not the exchange, for the MCE, for the waiver.
Got it.
And that has been one of the reasons why in San Mateo, as part of our waiver application for both mental health and substance use, we've offered that we're going to provide a full array of benefits for those beneficiaries, from kind of a low-level outpatient all the way to a system of care, full-service partnership type of a program. We believed, and with Dale's data, we believe further that that investment will pay for itself and more in bending the other cost curves. So we've been embarked on a number of integration strategies with health over the years, and these are basically the approaches that we work collaboratively, and we do that in a number of different arenas. Screening and identification, early intervention, try to the best we can to coordinate an integrated care. And then we share responsibility on the management of the outcomes, managing performance, looking at how we can share risk, and doing some joint planning on some of the higher cost clients. And we have a couple of projects going on right now where we're looking at pooling resources to help pay for people that are requiring long-term care types of interventions, rather than keeping them in silos. And we believe by having a single approach, pooling funding will create a better outcome. Just as an example of some of the integrated strategies, Dale or Sandra both, I think, talked about the high cost of people that are duly eligible for Medicaid and Medicare. And with our health plan, we've created a combined and integrated program for working with those individuals. And similar to the information that was provided, these are some of the challenges that we have with that population. So we have a relationship with the Health Plan of San Mateo, where the County Behavioral Health Services essentially manages the substance use mental health benefit for duly eligible people. And we do that in an integrated way. And thus far, we believe that managing that population more from a coordinated care rather than a siloed fee-for-service, uncoordinated care is starting to yield benefits, and we've listed a few there.
Can I ask you, Mr. Kaplan, what in San Mateo County, what portion of your Medi-Cal population is managed care and fee-for-service?
With the health plan, there's essentially all managed care in our health plan.
Total managed care, no fee for.
There's a few, but mostly more than 90% are in managed care with the health plan of San Mateo. Right. Again, that affords us a much.
That's part of your strategy.
Yeah.
Yeah, to integrate everything.
Yes.
Okay.
And we have actually, as an aside, we've been looking at how to integrate drug Medi-Cal, essentially be out of drug Medi-Cal and integrate substance use treatment within the general Medicaid population through the health plan of San Mateo.
Okay. All right.
So just to kind of highlight why parity is so important. So Tom McClellan, who's a preeminent researcher for substance use treatment in the country, did a study estimating the prevalence of substance use and dividing that between those with addictive disorders and those that he characterized as harmful use, meaning people that don't quite meet the diagnostic criteria for a substance use disorder. I took that information, extrapolated that to San Mateo County, and estimated that we have about 142,000 harmfully using people in the county, mostly employed, and not getting any kind of intervention treatment unless they come into contact with the law through DUI or drug diversion. So this is a population that if there was parity available to them to access substance use treatment, we believe that group of people would be more significantly served than they are now. Essentially, there is no service, there is no system of care for those people. And I would guess probably accurate that is the same in most every county in the state.
Okay.
Another example of how we've tried to integrate care, and we've been doing this actually for about 15 years, is our interface program where we've located mental health clinicians at 6 primary care sites. More recently, we've included a substance use counselor as well. And they work with people primarily with depression and moderate substance use disorders. It's a very brief treatment focus. People are seen about 6 times. A lot of people are seen in our county, almost 1,300 people in 08, 09. But a large number of those people are also uninsured, which we will hope to get into the waiver this coming time around.
I noticed that a large number of them are under 18.
Yeah, large number of children, and we have a special children's therapist in the clinic serving them. And the good thing is it's kind of the water cooler coordination with the primary care providers. They're in the clinics talking to the providers, exchanging consultation, et cetera. So as I said, when we looked at what we were going to do with the waiver, and as Dale and I think Sandra said, substance use was essentially left out of the California application, left totally to the discretion of individual counties whether they wanted to apply, and the mental health benefit was a pretty minimum, kind of what I would say is an old school benefit of 10 visits and, you know, every one size fits all. But when we looked at...
I want to go on record saying I'm totally opposed to that.
Yep.
That I thought that was one of the worst decisions made last year.
When we looked at what we thought we needed to do with our population, we decided that we were going to offer, again, this full continuum. We also have been fortunate that we've had a very supportive board of supervisors that puts county funding into substance use treatment and mental health services, so we have money available to match. We estimate that if we were able to gain eligibility for those 50% of adults currently in substance use treatment, we'd probably draw up to $2.5 million of federal money into our system. So there's still challenges. We think there's opportunities for coordinating care with privately insured people, that middle gap of harmful users. Electronic medical records and our health clinics have one electronic health record. Mental health has a different one. How do they exchange? How do they coordinate care in a way that works for people? You've probably heard about the FQHC same day billing problem. That's an issue. There are pretty significant cultural differences between behavioral health services and primary care, and those are just ongoing conversations that we have. And there's kind of a logistical capacity. Time, space, and staff are really big issues in our integration. And finally, with AOD services, we're going through a pretty massive transformation of our AOD providers to be able to participate in a Medicaid world. Essentially, what we've said is for years we've advocated that substance use is a health condition, but we haven't really had to act like a health care provider. And with the waiver, our providers are going to have to be a health care provider and all the backroom infrastructure that's going to require so that we can access those federal dollars. So that's our story in San Mateo and in a nutshell. Thank you.
Yeah, I had one question for you. When I chaired the health plan in Santa Clara County, we had a quality control committee that dealt with HEDIS. You know what mm-hmm. HEDIS is? It's the quality measurement system that we have in healthcare. Did you have such a system that included mental health and behavioral health, substance abuse as part of that?
Substance abuse is...
Measure results, basically, outcomes?
Yeah, we haven't, no.
Okay, is that something that...
Well, with our partners defined...
There's a health improvement?
Oh, yeah, yeah, we are looking at those constantly, and it's in the waiver.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to be improving health outcome. There's incentives through DSRIP.
Right.
Whatever that stands for. But it's for to improve health outcomes, so there's high incentives for clients to improve health outcomes, and we believe that reinforces this coordinated care.
So, like, if you have a provider, group of providers, you can see which ones perform to the standards mm-hmm. in terms of improved health care.
Yep.
Be able to measure that.
Yep, yes.
And then the other question I have is coordination of care with... the impact on other county departments. We've been focusing on the study here in terms of impact on the healthcare system, but we also have the human service system, the social services, and the, you know, the county criminal justice systems. Have you noticed any, or have you accomplished any kind of evaluation of what the impact of this has been on those systems? Like child welfare or your jail population and so forth?
Well, in the positive, some of the studies for the full service partnerships have shown pretty dramatic improvements in a lot of measures that are that sit with other county agencies like probation, child welfare, mm-hmm. Sheriffs, et cetera. So that's the good news on that. We also know from our conversations with probation, sheriff, and human services that particularly in this economy, they're seeing fairly substantial increases in people that they believe have substance use and mental health benefits, and they have less resources to deal with them.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Okay, thank you. Okay. Next, we'll hear from Nancy Pena from Santa Clara County.
Santa Clara County, and I'm going to talk a little bit about our county and our approach to the waiver process, but I think it really is worth mentioning that the San Mateo is really become a focal point for us across the state of counties in terms of learning what they're doing and the leadership they have for the approach that they've been taking.
And so we're really looking, you know, to see them as sort of a forerunners, I think, of where we need to go. And certainly we're really excited to be using Dale and the modeling tool that he's developing, and we're sort of right on the brink of getting the data and being able to really look at that. So I'm going to approach this from the way that counties, and if you think about it from various counties across the state, all of them are struggling with how can they participate in the waiver. Every county is very different in terms of the way they're structured and the services that they provide. So this is just a way of providing a little bit of a view from the context. In Santa Clara County, we are a large county. We're the sixth largest county in the state. 1.8 million people, very extremely diverse population. Over two-thirds of the population are either immigrant or first generation. So we have a tremendous amount of diversity in our community. We have very affluent communities in Santa Clara County and very poor communities as well. And over a quarter of a million are underinsured or uninsured. And as we sort of try to look at the prevalence issues and the magnitude, we're assuming that about 200,000 in our county are struggling with some sort of addiction or substance use problem, and 100,000 are struggling with mental illness. We are a health system, and that means that we have been organized as a health system in the county ordinance, and that includes, and it's been changing, it's a very fluid right now, but it includes the county hospital and the ambulatory clinics that are associated with our county hospital, the Department of Alcohol and Drug Services, the Mental Health Department, and the Public Health Department. Collectively, we have about 5,100 FTEs, employees, in our system, and we serve close to a half a million. 264,000 are quote-unquote patients. That means they're entered into a treatment system, and one of the three systems, and then well over 200,000 are also touched by public health through the various activities. So we have a lot of people that that we care for in our system. At the same time, we've been, as has every other county, going through significant budget reductions. We've had 11 years now of budget reductions. It's been impacting every part of our system. And as the general economic crisis is also impacting people, we have less people with insurance. So we have more and more people who are coming to the safety net system for their care because they've lost jobs and they've lost their insurance. Then the coming year, we're facing about a $230 million reduction, and then another $40 million is estimated will come when the May revise comes before us. And just in the health and hospital system, it's going to be at least $80 million. We have just submitted our plan for an $80 million reduction for our system. We also have been working collectively as a health system. Leadership in the organization has really been working very hard to think about the future with healthcare reform, what's the best for our community, and we have developed a vision of being a fully integrated system that not only embraces environmental health and issues of healthy living environments, which includes parks and recreation and things like that, but all the way down to the treatment system and ultimately the hospital system and the inpatient system. So we are very committed to trying to eliminate the silos and blur the boundaries and have integrated care. Still, when the payment system and the structure is really geared towards paying this sick care system with very sort of isolated funding mechanisms. We have been involved in several activities over the last several years that are moving us and making us ready for healthcare reform and more integration. We have a local initiative which right now is serving approximately 7,000. And that is run through our Valley Health Plan, the county HMO. And we entered into a contract with them, the mental health department did, to provide mental health services for that population. So that was our beginning foray into providing a mental health benefit to another insurance besides Medi-Cal. And we also have an integrated homeless team, also the very deep end service, but lots of lessons learned in terms of ways in which you can sort of bend the cost curve for those who are have the most complex and comorbid conditions. We have a psychiatrist that we have embedded in our methadone clinic as a part of an extension of the homeless integrated service. We have drug and alcohol that is also entering into adding more substance use counseling into medical homes. And they're really testing a model right now that is looking at screening and access within the medical home FQ clinic. At the same time, substance abuse, we're in a relationship with our Department of Alcohol and Drug Services, and they are going to be taking our mental health staff through a certification process to certify them as substance use counselors in the FQHCs that we're working in. And in mental health, 2 years ago, because of budget problems, we made a huge decision to move our psychiatrists and licensed clinical social workers from our outpatient mental health clinics into three FQHC clinics that we were co-located on their campus, same campus. And we now extended that to four, and we probably will go to another two. And we're very excited about this, and the model is evolving as we speak. We started sort of in a two-phase process, the first being clearly a strictly administrative and technical in terms of moving our staff into the FQHC and bringing with them their patients, those patients that were doing well and really what we call are in recovery and would be able to be served adequately and appropriately in a primary care setting, but they still are an SMI population. At the same time, we've extended ourselves in this bi-directional model into the primary care setting, and we're now serving about 1,600 SMI clients from the specialty mental health system and another 700 from the primary care from primary care referrals, which really will be episodic anxiety depression clients who will serve in their primary care
setting. Adults or children?
Adults. And we are now moving more into kids, but on the adult side is where we've focused.
Okay.
For us, the low-income health plan really is, it should be LIPHP, shouldn't it?
Well.
Just now realizing that.
Sounds
and I just
good.
Love that slide so much. But for us, as we've sort of, now that we've taken out so much. Yeah, really. Thank you. We've been testing. This is a huge math problem for us in our system when we're trying to look at 263 folks who are using a system that pretty much is silo-based system to try to get a view of who they are and also how much funds we will have to be able to finance the benefit that we're going to be making available with the substance use and mental health and primary care benefit. So really, this is sort of a simplistic way of thinking about it, but you have only a certain amount of local certified public expenditures available to you if you're a county, and these are dollars that you're already spending on an uninsured population, and that's what you have to invest in. And now we're learning that we actually may have some savings to invest in, but to start with, we have only our local certified public expenditures. Secondly, we have to decide, you know, how broad and robust a plan we're going to have, and certainly the more service we offer, the more expensive it becomes and the fewer who can be enrolled. So finally, the number of enrolled is really based on your amount of certified public expenditures you have and what benefit you choose and how much you estimate that that's going to cost. And that really gives you the number of enrollees you can put into your plan. And we have been struggling with this as we went through without the benefit of the information that Dale is going to be providing us. So this has been pretty much an intellectual process with as much data as we possibly have. So again, here are the three departments, who they're serving right now. And what this diagram really represents is the difference between the populations we're serving right now and how much more we think each of us will need to serve as we go forward and start enrolling those folks who are eligible for Medi-Cal. Or if we are not expanding our coverage initiative, but we are expanding a Medi-Cal expansion program, we are developing one. So the logic goes something like this, that you determine first the number that we're serving collectively, that's our 264,000. You determine the number that we're serving concurrently, meaning who are we serving in each other's systems. And this actually represents somewhat a visual of how many we're serving in common. It actually appears to be, and we'll see how the data comes out, because we've had to dump in data from very different treatment system electronic databases. But it appears to be that we have little overlap between mental health and substance use, and about one-tenth or less of our consumers are also served in the primary care system. So each other's universe is really quite separate in terms of who we serve. We are then needing to really determine what it costs for that person who is only using the primary care system versus using the other two systems as well. So that's part of what Dale's data will really help us with. We'll have to estimate the number served that are eligible for Medi-Cal in 2014. So within this whole universe of who we're serving right now, which primarily in the Valley Medical Center in the health and hospital system in Santa Clara County are Medicare, Medi-Cal, and uninsured. We have a subset of people who have insurance, especially in the deeper end of our primary care system, the specialty system, where we'll have contracts with Kaiser or Blue Cross or other private plans. But in terms of our general primary care system and substance use and mental health, it's primarily the low-income population or those who have public insurance. We have to know, on number five, how much CPE we have available. We have to decide what our benefit is going to be, and then we have to estimate how much new demand we think there is out there in our systems. For mental health, it's how much physical health need is there. For substance use, it's how much physical health need there is, as well as need into our systems. So it gets pretty complicated in terms of trying to go through an exercise of determining how much resource we have and what we want to do and what we're going to be able to do. Our plan, I can't believe I did this all the way through, I think. That's because we keep calling it LIP, so I put the P there. The program design that we have is through our current health. I know. It's through our current health system. I mean, it's administered through the County Valley Health Plan, which is our HMO. And they'll be doing all the administrative utilization management and member services. Our finance, that's integrated centralized finance of the health system, will do all the financial analysis and cost reports and billing and that whole part of the system. The enrollment of those folks into the new Medi-Cal expansion program will be done by financial counselors that also already exist in the health and hospital system. And we will be targeting a population at below 75% of federal poverty level. We will not be charging any copay. And we will increase the ceiling of who can be served by level of poverty based on really how we're performing and how things are working out as we go forward. Our healthcare coverage initiative will not be expanded, and we will be grandfathering in those who are under 134% under 134% into the mental health and substance use benefit. We expect 30,000 new enrollees into the system, and we are assuming that 7% are going to be needing mental health services. Now, again, this is sort of based on our Medi-Cal population, so we're sort of modeling after the current Medi-Cal population and assuming some of the same problems will come forward, and the same number of people will need our services. We have about $10 million in local CPE that we can make available for this. We have an uninsured clinic, we have an urgent care, and we have other services that are going to the uninsured population. All that will be the services that we have to offer, the dollars that we have to offer towards the benefit. We're looking at an array where the primary care benefit will be the benefit that is required, that mental health will also be provided through the County Medi-Cal Specialty Center, so it'll be carved out to the public mental health system. We also will have the service access just as the Medi-Cal population accesses the services, and the same range of services. As with San Mateo, we made the same decision that we weren't going to limit the service array that we made available. Once we begin serving this population, we really are compelled to offer them what they need based on medical necessity. So that's the way we've designed our service. We'll also have in our uninsured, we have it already in our uninsured clinic, special SSI application assisters from the Social Services Agency. So through a collaboration with the Social Services Agency, we have staff who are housed in our uninsured clinic so that they can help people who truly are disabled to begin to generate the application that will be successful in their obtaining SSI. So we want to make sure that people have access to whatever any benefit that they may be eligible for.
Does that include youth?
Youth?
Young people?
It does not.
Like
at this time.
The transition ages?
Yes, over the age of 18.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes. So
we're having a bill hearing tomorrow on SSI processing for foster youth, for example.
Yeah.
Get the foster kids in SSI.
Absolutely, yeah. We for the substance use benefit, we basically have the goal of doing exactly what we're doing with mental health. They just don't have the same amount of CPE available. We are right now, based on the analysis we get, if we can get a good compelling reason why we can offer the full benefit for substance use, we will end up doing that. Again, using the same procedure codes and costs and things like that that are related to the mental health system, with sort of a parallel procedure code and cost-based rate system. The additional steps that we really need to engage in as we go forward, and we're working on right now, is of course to complete the fiscal analysis and the model that we're going to be using to finalize the substance use benefit and the administrative structure that we're going to use for the health plan as we go forward, to finalize our care delivery model, to define the performance tracking metrics that we will have that will begin to demonstrate the both the cost savings as well as the outcomes that we're achieving in terms of client outcomes. There will be training needs. As Stephen mentioned, they are two different cultural environments. Working in a primary care setting is very different from working in a sort of carved out specialty center or system. And so we will have to, and we're right now starting to train our staff in working in a primary care environment with some of the practices that are used in those settings. And then we're also taking a look at the overall structure of the health system and what changes we need to make in terms of our health system and taking it forward to the future. Three things are really important to us as we continue to move forward. One is to really ensure that we have the kind of system in place that can handle multiple conditions, both from the level of prevention and early intervention, but also in terms of intensity and complexity. And when you start thinking of three sort of types of conditions that may have varying levels of severity to them, it's a challenge to make sure that you're bringing the right service to the right conditions. Having those services delivered in a person-centered way, and really with the value of putting the person or the patient in medical care at the center of everything we do, is extremely important to us, so that we really are getting the outcomes that we're looking for. And then, as Dale put so well, we really are talking about bending the cost curve, and we believe firmly that it does mean you have to redesign your delivery system.
Yeah, thank you. I had a question. Are in terms of like a policy direction, we talk about bending the cost delivery curve, but also when you talk about person-centered values, health outcomes is the number one value. You know, we want to. Why are we doing all this? We're doing all this to improve health outcomes. It's not about spending money as much as it is about, you know, making people healthier. And reducing the chronic conditions that people have and so forth. So does the system now that we have in Sacramento need to be changed? That's the question I want to ask you. Yes or no? Maybe give me your short version of that question. What does it work? And what do we need to do?
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, I think one of the things that we've learned in this is that healthcare is local. So how you actually organize it is going to have to be done at the local level. But I think at the state level, and I do believe this is what the state is trying to accomplish in its waiver, is trying to provide more integrated care and trying to move it downstream a little bit so we do more prevention. But I think we need to really focus on that. We all get lost in the cost because we've only got so much money.
Yeah.
The good news is if you improve health outcomes, you actually reduce cost.
I think that's been proven that we go to the...
Absolutely. How much... I guess I just question how much that's fully understood within all of our systems. I think we just need to work more at helping that information get out. And then as we see these counties begin to demonstrate it on the ground, then we'll have solid California-based evidence to demonstrate that case.
Okay. Because I'm looking at it from the standpoint of a policymaker up here in Sacramento, and I see, you know, Dale's information about how we can, you know, reduce chronic conditions and so forth. And I see the approaches that I'm very familiar with the county of Santa Clara, of course, and the San Mateo County. And, you know, and how you operate, you know, and you have to look at that certified public expenditure. And you said that your method gets you more federal money. How about you, Nancy? What do you think about the system you're creating? Will it be able to draw down more money, federal money?
Yes. I mean, we're assuming about a $10 million drawdown from what we do.
So you're changing everything so that you're facilitating that?
Yeah, we're trying to maximize, bring every cent we have forward so that we can make that work. I think from a policy perspective, one of the things that was disappointing to most of us was the absence of the substance use benefit as being part of the waiver. And when you see the data, it just doesn't make sense not to have that. And knowing that parity will be here in 2014 as well. Mm-hmm. And so I think from policy perspective, many of us felt that we had to move forward with substance use. If not to point the way in terms of where the rest of the state needs to go, knowing that many counties had no CPE whatsoever to commit to this, and many would have if there had some incentive funding or some source of funding, would have developed more substance use benefit in their plans.
Okay. Okay, well, thank you very much, and I appreciate your information. This is really revealing. It's pretty clear, though. Very clear. And we'll move on to our next panel. Comments from Victor Kogler and Steve Meilhart. Victor is our executive director for Drug Policy Institute. And Steve, of course, is vice president of Aegis Medical Systems and represents CADP. You could tell me what CADP stands for, full acronym, Steve. So welcome, and I'll turn it over to the two gentlemen to address the Committee on Substance Abuse Disorder Treatment as it relates to the implementation of the 1115 waiver. So, right. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bell, for this invitation to
you're welcome.
Appear before the committee. I'm Victor Kogler, and I'll use my time wisely so that Steve and our following presenter will have time. I think it's interesting that the previous presentation left on the note of disappointment that substance use disorder treatment was not more explicitly contained in the waiver application. Yeah. However, our bridge to health care reform is contained in four paragraphs in the special terms and conditions, which specify a behavioral health needs assessment and plan to be conducted. That's in the design process right now. And what the purpose of this is to conduct this assessment, to submit a plan to CMS, which outlines the steps and infrastructure necessary to meet requirements of a benchmark plan. This is for the expansion population, and ensure strong availability of behavioral health services statewide no later than 2014. The plan is to be presented to CMS in March 2012, and the plan goes to CMS on October 2012. What I would like to you have my printed material, so I'll just highlight briefly the key elements that make this needs assessment plan so important. Is it one that it needs to focus equally on both systems, on caseloads across the full spectrum of mental health and substance use disorders, both as they occur individually and as they co-occur. Presently, the substance use disorder treatment system does not have a mandate for indigent care, as we have in the rest of the health system under the Welfare and Institutions Code. The block grant pretty much covers that, and that's inadequate. The SAMHSA recognizes that there's nationally only 10% of those seeking treatment get it. This is the treatment gap. These are the folks who are unable to access care. The National Survey on Drug Use and Health indicates that nearly 50% of those who don't receive care do so because of a lack of coverage. That's to say, I'd go if I could pay for it. In our case, I think we see that health care reform will have a disproportionate impact on our system relative to others in the state. It will bring about an expansion of the caseload as more people become eligible, and will also produce a major shift in financing. So it's not being able that we will see people who are currently covered under the block grant will shift to Medicaid, to Medi-Cal, perhaps under pay-for-performance sorts of reimbursement strategies. 60% of the current caseload in California does not have coverage now. Most of those are male, many are offenders. And this is a group that we're going to have to gear up to serve, not only in terms of numbers, but also with infrastructure. The needs assessment has to capture in both quantitative and qualitative terms. I think it's very important that we get an objective, clear snapshot of what the system is, so that we can then develop a plan. Like in anything, if you define the question well enough, the solution becomes far simpler. And so that we have a clear set of stepping stones from where we are now to get to 2014. I think key issues are workforce, IT, provider infrastructure, and also identification of treatment needs by caseload segment. Women, youth and families, offenders, for example, if we see people who are coming out of prison, who are the people who would be eligible under Prop 36 for treatment instead of incarceration, will have coverage. And the question is, what do we do with them? Can we design a Medi-Cal benefit that's going to be specifically tailored to the needs of those people? And then finally, persons with co-occurring substance use and mental health disorders. And again, across that full spectrum. So seriously mentally ill with substance use disorders, substance use disorder clients with a co-occurring mental disorder. The other thing about infrastructure, and I've actually had the opportunity to give this statistics in a prior hearing about a year and a half ago, and I'd just like you to think about it and what this means about the whole system. But in a large Bay Area county, in the 10-11 fiscal year, the median salary for a substance use counselor is $14.
$14 an hour?
Yeah, that's median. Half of them.
Wow.
Mean is 19. And the $19 an hour, I have to say, if you've got two dependents, you're in safety net country. You're just under 20% of poverty.
You're eligible for Medi-Cal.
Yeah. So, you may have people who are, buffing the floors in this building and making more money. So think about what that means in terms, not just the workforce directly, but around the whole rest of the system that, we're only as good as our staff. So we want to make sure that this new benefit for substance use disorders is broad enough to provide the spectrum of services required by this diverse caseload. And we need, we're not homogenous. I think we need different benefits for youth, and I say youth and families because youth treatment is family treatment, than we do for male offenders, for example. and that reimbursement at a level that finances the full cost of service. It would be shameful if what we ended up with was still $14 an hour counselors. The other thing I want to add is that the language of the special terms and conditions makes a distinction, I believe, between the benchmark plan, which will cover the folks who come about in the expansion, versus the rest of Medi-Cal. And I think, we need to look at what happens to the current drug Medi-Cal carve-out system versus what happens to the benchmark plan. I've had people observe that we could end up with a benchmark, which is intended to be a minimal, that's better than what our current system is in drug Medi-Cal. So we've got two things to look at. Lastly, there is also provision for evaluation of the entire waiver itself. And I think what we heard here, from the counties that are actually been able to finance and organize substance use disorder services within their 1115 waiver, within their low-income health program, is that needs to be studied as well, because we've got real world stuff here that to measure cost offsets, health outcomes that occur from what counties in California are doing right now. And I think that's going to be very important, even though ultimately it'd be a small part of the overall waiver.
Okay.
So thank you.
Thank you very much. And I appreciate your work and advocacy. Now we'll turn it over to Steve, and he's going to represent our providers, hear what they have to say.
Mr. Bell and members of the committee, we'd like to thank you, first of all, for asking us to be here to share some information. You've received some very meaty data from the prior panel in terms of the costs. Michael Cunningham, who's the acting director of the Department of Alcohol and Drug Programs, made a presentation last week at the CADA conference, and he had some pretty meaningful statistics that bowled us over also. And we tried to summarize those in this little two-page summary that we provided. But some of the things I'd like to highlight are over 20,000 alcohol-involved fatal and injury collisions occur as a consequence of substance use disorders, and 287,000 AOD-related hospitalizations occur each year. 279,000 AOD-related emergency visits occur. Over 636,000 alcohol and other drug arrests. Alcohol, untreated alcohol and substance use disorder cost California in excess of $60 billion, B billion. Many need but do not receive AOD services, and that's because of some of the stuff that Victor just mentioned, the limitations in funding, the limitations in services. But of the age 12 and older, approximately 3.3 million people in California would like to have treatment but cannot afford it and do not have coverage for it. Ages 18 to 25-year-olds, over 1 million people. Ages 26 and older, nearly 2 million people. Ages 60 and older, over 1 million people. And these are people that need but do not receive alcohol and other drug services.
Steve, would you describe those as in that pyramid that we saw earlier?
Precisely.
Yes.
Those are at the lower part of the pyramid that are not the top 10% that are receiving services.
So they're not the real extremely serious cases, but the people that have substance abuse problems in general, but they aren't at the higher level, serious level, addiction level.
And as Dale pointed out, treatment works, and we know that it has positive outcomes. In Mr. Cunningham's presentation, treatment outcomes include 87% increase in job training, 65% increase in abstinence, 58% increase in recovery activities, 33% increase in employment, 12% increase in number of no arrests, 10% increase in independent living, 8% reported no health problems. So I guess the point of that is that the 1115 waiver should absolutely have included substance use disorder as a mandated benefit. There should have been a minimum benefit put in there. It shouldn't have been an option for the counties to do on a local match basis. It's hard for me to understand why, in the face of the data, people wouldn't say we need to spend a little money here to save a whole lot more money over there. And we have gone on record since last September encouraging the inclusion of the 1115 waiver to include substance use disorder treatment. We provided the committee with a copy of our letter to the Honorable Daryl Steinberg, dated September 30th. Attached to that letter is a one-page summary of the minimum services that we feel are important to be included in the 1115 waiver. We know that under the Affordable Care Act, that substance use disorders will be listed as a national priority. They will be included as a minimum benefit. Health plans will be required to cover substance use disorders as essential health benefits and include evidence-based preventative health services such as ESPRT. We know that parity coverage will be required under the Affordable Care Act as healthcare reform rolls out. Why we're not preparing ourselves and starting that process in the supposed bridge to the future 1115 waiver and not including substance use disorder is just, it doesn't make common sense. It doesn't make sense to have excluded it or to have earmarked it as an optional thing that a county could do if they wanted to come up with their own funding. We are pleased that some counties are taking this seriously and are moving forward on their own, but we really think that we need to take this thing seriously as a state and to move forward. We would like to applaud you for your efforts in bringing forth the Substance Use Disorder and Mental Health Parity Act for a number of times now. I think this is your fourth or fifth attempt. We encourage you.
I can't remember how many.
We
it is the fifth.
We hope and pray that it gets through the process and gets signed because it's so important to this state to start dealing with this sort of issue head on. It's frightening when cuts are occurring in places like CDCR, which has virtually eliminated the rehabilitation portion of the Department of Corrections. They just keep cutting treatment, and people just keep revolving back into the prison system at a huge cost. We need to deal with those costs head on by preventative measures, by treatment. And I suppose that's in the interest of time,
for you.
All of it has.
Can you give me any insights about why the logic was not to include the substance abuse in the 1115 waiver?
Initially, the 1115 waiver was put together by the Department of Health Care Services, and historically, it was a hospital-based waiver for disproportionate care subsidies. The alcohol and drug portion of it was not even going to be considered. And in forming the committee to put the 1115 waiver together, there were no representatives of the alcohol and drug provider community or county administrators. At the insistence of the Department of Alcohol and Drug Programs, they've kind of forced the committee to allow for one representative, Al Sinella, who is the president of CADPE, the California Association of Alcohol and Drug Program Executives. And that is the group that I'm here representing today as a board member and a legislative chair. And he was like a noisy record, just repeating over and over again, this is so important. We really need to deal with this. But the fact is that the folks that were on that committee are coming from a very different mindset. They're coming from primary care, hospital care, and they don't really recognize the importance in many cases of substance use disorder. It's hard to believe when you look at the data that the prior panel presented, how they can possibly ignore it. But there was a mindset in the beginning not to include it. They reluctantly included representation, but the mindset at the end of the day is they don't understand it, they don't know how to fund it, and it got kind of also mentioned.
Okay. Well, okay. It seems to me, you know, I'm sitting here as a guy that's dealing with a huge budget problem for the state and having to cut billions of dollars of programs and stuff like that. And I see one agency that's growing like crazy. That's the healthcare system for prisoners. It went from, I think one of our members said, $500 million like 4 years ago to $2.5 billion now, just in that short period of time. So we're at a point where the healthcare system for prisoners is the best system in California. And we're getting to the point where if you want to get good health care, you got to go to prison.
I would argue that's not necessarily the best system, but perhaps the most expensive system.
It's the most expensive, yeah, I would say. So I think we're spending money on the top of the pyramid, you know, like you were referencing and everybody else has. We're not spending the money on the other side. Mm-hmm. And that's going to, it's going to end up costing the taxpayers a lot of money in a lot of bigger ways.
Yeah, it's almost a comparison to that 550 that Dale was referencing.
Yes.
5%.
Well, I appreciate
50% of the budget.
I appreciate you being here, and we're going to have one last presenter.
Thank you very much.
And thank you very much. We have Dr. Shermack, and he's got a lot of hats. He's, of course, a physician. We're going to hear the physician perspective, and he's, of course, president of our California Society of Addiction Medicine, and he's also co-chair of our Governor's Prevention Advisory Subcommittee on Screening and Brief Intervention and Referral Treatment. And representing here today are California Society of Addiction Medicine. And welcome, Doctor, and appreciate your work and also your organization. You're the frontline guys preventing treatment. So,
and Assemblyman
welcome.
Bell and Sunshine Borelli, I appreciate very much the opportunity to be here on behalf of the California Society of Addiction Medicine. We've heard some really important data. I'm going to talk about the clinical standpoint. I'm going to come from a perspective of looking at what would be the most effective treatment package that we should be providing to people with substance abuse problems. The data is the data. It doesn't pay attention to the budget. It tells us what is effective, and so that's what I'm here to talk about. The California Society of Addiction Medicine is a specialty society of approximately 400 physicians that was founded in 1973. We've been a state chapter of the American Society of Addiction Medicine since about 1989. And our society is dedicated to improving the treatment of alcoholism and other addictions through education of physicians and other healthcare workers, through promoting research, prevention, and implementation of evidence-based treatment. We represent the voice of addiction medicine on public policy and clinical issues in California. We believe that the national health care reform, that it provides California with the best opportunity in our 38 years as a society to not just expand but also significantly improve the quality of care given to people who require treatment for chemical dependence. The availability of treatment for substance abuse in California has lagged behind the treatment needs of our people. 2.3 million Californians need treatment for alcohol use but don't receive it. 750,000 need treatment for drug use but don't receive it. And only one out of every 10 adolescents who needs treatment for drug use receives it, and only 25% of them receive sufficient treatment. And most of that treatment is through the juvenile justice system. But we also lag in the quality of treatment here in California due to the lack of parity for substance abuse treatment. And that's resulted in, one, just decades of this misguided carve-out and therefore limitation of substance abuse treatment benefits by insurance health care plans. And second, the failure to provide adequate psychiatric care for the up to 40% of substance abuse users or substance abusers who have mental illness. And we fail to give adequate substance abuse treatment to the up to 30% of mental health patients who abuse substances. And third, we fail to fund medications that have been proven to assist treatment and recovery. Finally, the Patient Protection and Affordability Care Act, combined with the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act, require that all health plans include treatment for substance abuse among their basic benefits and assure that substance abuse treatment is covered in exactly the same way as all other medical and surgical benefits. Together, these landmark acts improve the availability and the quality of care for people with addiction. Together, these two acts end a long history of systemic, institutionalized discrimination against individuals suffering from addictive disease. So how does healthcare reform benefit substance abuse treatment? Well, one, all public and private healthcare plans are mandated to include substance abuse treatment. Two, the Medi-Cal will be available at 133% of the federal poverty level. Three, 6 million more Californians will have health insurance, including many of the most unfortunate, the homeless, the unemployed, the ex-offenders. And fourth, Substance abuse treatment will be integrated into our basic health care system on a par with all other chronic illnesses. But the challenge before us now is to design what the basic substance abuse treatment benefit should look like. What will define quality treatment under health care reform? A few evidence-based principles have emerged by consensus of the National Institute of Drug Abuse, the National Institute of Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism, and the Institute of Medicine. And CSAM supports the following guidelines, simple principles for effective treatment. Addiction is a chronic disease. Addiction is treatable. Addiction treatment must be ongoing and continuous. No single treatment is effective for all individuals, and co-occurring medical and psychiatric conditions must be addressed along with substance abuse treatment. To begin, the only limitation on substance abuse treatment must be medical necessity. People with addictive disease must be treated exactly like diabetics and hypertensives. When the illness relapses, treatment must be administered. We need to treat people when they're ill and not put a cap on their benefits. Second, there must be no wrong door for entry into treatment. This means that primary care providers, emergency department and hospital providers, and mental health providers all must be trained in basic screening, intervention, and referral to treatment services, the basic expert services. Third, the basic substance abuse benefit package must include a continuum of care that includes medical detoxification when necessary, outpatient and inpatient treatment, aftercare, and medical and psychiatric care as needed. Outpatient treatment must be seen as the mainstay, with inpatient reserved for the minority of higher risk patients. And the minimum treatment dose for any episode should be 90 days. Treatment for patients with co-occurring disorders, medical and psychiatric, must be fully integrated into substance abuse treatment and vice versa. Our patients often suffer from multiple illnesses, and the idea of medical homes is to stop dividing their treatment into separate silos. Effective outreach to previously uninsured populations will have to be developed, and a hotline should be provided for treatment on request for those who recognize their own need for treatment. Fourth, the role of physicians must be increased in the following ways if substance abuse treatment is to be maximally effective. First, evidence clearly demonstrates that medication-assisted treatment should be fully covered without the onerous restrictions that we have today. Second, comprehensive psychiatric services for substance abusers requires the assessment and diagnostic skills of physicians. And third, integrating substance abuse treatment into mainstream primary medical care will be facilitated by involving physicians experienced in addiction medicine in training other physicians and healthcare workers. Workforce training should be a priority in order to increase the skill level and number of current substance abuse counselors, as well as challenging the years of ignoring substance abuse that's been practiced by most physicians and specialties unrelated to addiction. Fifth, and this personally is my most important one, an adolescent treatment system has to be built in California. More than 90% of adults with current substance abuse disorders started using before they were 18 years old. Half of those began before 15. As a result, in over 50% of cases, addiction is a chronic medical illness of pediatric onset. Healthcare reform finally provides sufficient insurance-based funding to permit treatment of early stages of addiction. Additional funding could also come from more effective regulation and taxing of California's de facto legalization of marijuana, a drug that does its greatest harm to adolescents. Any diversion of revenue from marijuana sales to a general government budgets before building a fully functional treatment system for adolescents is strongly opposed by the California Society. So in summary, California has a unique opportunity to create a substance abuse treatment basic benefit that works, that's documented to save lives and save money. But we must be careful to assure that the basic benefit provided to Californians embodies the evidence-based principles of treating addiction as a chronic illness that requires an ongoing continuum of care tailored to the individual as medically necessary and sophisticated enough to include the full range of medical and psychiatric services. This is not a wish list. It's the distilled experience of experts throughout the field of medicine and addiction. And unless California builds a treatment system that's based on these principles, we will waste a unique, once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to significantly reduce the harm done by alcohol and drug abuse on individual Californians, on California families, and on the entire state budget. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Cermak. I had a question for you, since you do focus on the youth. And we saw earlier the presentation talking about the general population in terms of focusing on reducing and getting a dividend from developing prevention programs. Would you say that doing that at the earliest possible, the earlier you do that, the bigger the dividend is going to be over time?
In medicine, we're clear that with any chronic disease, early diagnosis is the key to keeping it from having a more profound and more expensive effect on someone. So early diagnosis is the key. We need pediatricians to be involved in the early diagnosis of chemical dependence, because